Oh, shit. It's been a long, dark night, and I've been waiting for the morning. It's been a long, hard fight, and I see a brand new day at dawning. I've been looking for the sunshine, ain't seen in so long. Everything's gonna work out fine. Everything's gonna be alright. It's gonna be okay. I can see the light of a clear blue morning. I can see the light of a brand new day. I can see the light of a clear blue morning. Everything's gonna work out fine. It's gonna be okay.
I can see the light.
I can see.
Good morning. Thank you. And isn't it a glorious day for this wonderful occasion at Radford University? I am Joe Scartelli, and it is my privilege to serve as the Interim Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs here at Radford University. Today, I also have the esteemed honor of serving as your Master of Ceremonies. Before I go any further, I'd like to recognize and thank the Radford University Wind Symphony under the direction of Wayne Gallops, and also the Radford University Highlander Pipes and Drums under the direction of Dr. Tim Channel. Thank you, folks. And now I will begin with the introduction of the platform party. First and of course foremost, the person we're all here to celebrate today, Radford University's 7th president, Dr. Brian O. Hemphill. There are several members of our platform party that will be speaking later this morning and will be introduced individually. At this time, I will ask each person to stand as I call his or her name, and I ask the audience to hold your applause until all names have been called. Yes, please be seated. Thank you. We'll have to start with that part. We'll begin on this side, Dr. Deidre Trent, Commonwealth of Virginia, Secretary of Education. Mr. Peter Blake, Director of the State Council for Higher Education, of Higher Education for Virginia. Dr. E. Gordon Gee, President of West Virginia University. Dr. Janetta Brazell, Vice Chancellor Emeritus of Student Affairs at the University of Arkansas. Dr. Bruce Brown, Mayor of Radford and also adjunct faculty member in the college, our College of Business and Economics. Dr. Nathaniel Bishop, President of Jefferson College of Health Sciences. Dr. John So, Mace Bearer and Chair and Associate Professor of Geology. The Rector of the Board of Visitors, Mr. Chris Wade. Vice Rector of the Board of Visitors, Dr. Javed Siddiqui. Jacinda Jones, President of the Student and Government Association. Dr. Carter Turner, President of our Faculty Senate. Sandra Bond, President of the Administrative and Professional Faculty Senate. Marie Testerman, President of the Classified Staff Senate. Kevin Rogers, President of the Alumni Association. And Dr. George Lowe, Dean of the College of Business and Economics. Thank you. Please be seated. And now, our Radford University Vice Presidents. Melissa Wolstein, Vice President for University Advancement. Kitty McCarthy, Vice President for Enrollment Management. Dr. Irvin Clark, Vice President for Student Affairs. Joe Carpenter, Chief Communications Officer and Vice President for University Relations. Danny Kemp, Chief Information Officer, Vice President for Information Technology. Richard Alvarez, Chief Finance Officer and Vice President for Finance and Administration. We also have with us Dr. Paul Hill, Chancellor of the West Virginia Higher Education Policy Commission, Secretary Kay Goodwin, West Virginia Department of Education and the Arts, Dr. John Peters, President Emeritus of Northern Illinois University. At this time, I am pleased to introduce other members of the Radford University Board of Visitors. Bob Archer, Krisha Chakra, Kevon Dupree, Dr. Rachel Folks, Marianne Hovis, Mark Lawrence, A.J. Robinson, Georgia Ann Snyder Falkingham. Thank you. Also on the platform, we have from Radford University our other administrative officials, Robert Lindenberg, Director of Athletics, and also our academic deans, Dr. Kenneth Cawley, the Dean of Education and Human Development, Dr. Ken Cox, the Waldron College of Health and Human Services, Professor Margaret Devaney, College of Visual and Performing Arts, Dr. Dennis Grady, College of Graduate Studies and Research, Dr. Kate Hawkins, College of Humanities and Behavioral Sciences, Steve Helm, Dean of the Library. Dr. Orion Rogers, College of Science and Technology. We are also pleased to have, in addition, additionally, former colleagues of Dr. Hemphill, Dr. Teresa Powell from Temple University, William Limskin, Board of Governors, West Virginia State University, Dr. Orlando McMeans, West Virginia State University, Dr. Ainsley Carey, University of Southern California, Dr. Derek Gregg, the University of Tulsa, Dr. John Jones, University of Alabama at Birmingham, Dr. T. Ramon Stewart, Ford Valley State University, Angie Dreesen, Illinois Central College. Thank you all. At this moment, I would also like to recognize in the audience our federal, state, and locally elected or appointed officials or their representatives. Could I ask you to please stand and be recognized? Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, I ask that you stand for the posting of the colors by the Radford University Army ROTC Color Guard. We will then have the national anthem sung by Dr. Youngmi Kim, Assistant Professor of Music, then followed by the invocation provided by Dr. Nathaniel Bishop, President of the Jefferson College of Health Sciences.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the was so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet
Let us pray. Almighty God, we come with a sense of gratitude and thanks for the myriad of ways in which you bless our lives. This is a bright and beautiful day that you have created on this distinctive occasion that calls us together, and indeed we rejoice and are glad in it. We thank you for the rich history that brings us to this moment, and for all of those who have faithfully laid the foundation for this day. We invoke your presence as we gather this morning for the inauguration and investiture of Dr. Brian O. Hemphill, as he takes upon himself the mantle of leadership to guide this, our beloved Radford University. We pray that you would bless him and empower him with divine wisdom as he sets the vision and leads and directs this institution of higher learning. Bless his lovely wife, who stands beside him, and his wonderful family, and indeed all of the teams that support his presidency. We pray that you would consecrate all who serve this college, that it might continue to impart its treasures of wisdom and knowledge to the students who come to prepare themselves for careers and for service that will enrich communities far and wide. As you have been our help and hope in ages past, continue to be for us both our pillar of support and a beacon into the future, so that guided by your spirit, we will maintain our focus and strengthen our commitment in educating and shaping women and men in this institution of higher education. Hear this, our prayer, which we offer in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you, members of the Radford University ROTC, and Dr. Kim and Dr. Bishop. Christopher Wade, rector of the Board of Visitors, received his undergraduate degree in government from the University of Notre Dame. Yes, please be seated. He received his degree in government from the University of Notre Dame and his MBA from George Mason University. Throughout his professional career of information technology and management, Mr. Wade has fulfilled his passion of helping others address organizational challenges and solving real-world business problems. And now to provide our welcome, Rector Christopher Wade.
Please stand. Just kidding.
Dr. Hemphill,
distinguished presidents, delegates, the Honorable Secretary of Education, Board of Visitors of the University of Radford, esteemed faculty, alumni, family of Dr. Hemphill, and guests. Wow, that was long. It is my great honor on behalf of the University of Radford University's Board of Visitors to welcome you to the inauguration of Dr. Brian O. Hemphill as the 7th president of Radford University. This is an historic occasion for Radford University. It is the 7th time in the university's 106-year history that we have welcomed a new president to its campus. On behalf of the many diverse members of our community, I thank you for being present here today to share our pride in Radford, our commitment to the university's tradition of education, and our excitement for the future possibilities. May today serve as an opportunity to join together to celebrate the rich history and strong traditions of Radford University. As we prepare for the future, a future that will be led by President Hemphill, with the support of the entire campus community. As a board, I just want to say that we are very excited and have the utmost confidence in Dr. Hemphill and his ability to lead Radford University as our president. Once again, on behalf of the Board of Visitors, welcome to Radford University and welcome to the inauguration of Dr. Brian Hemphill.
Dr. Dietra Trent was appointed as Secretary of Education by Governor Terry McAuliffe earlier this year. She had previously served as Deputy Secretary of Education. She also served as Deputy Secretary of Education in Governor Tim Kaine's administration, and as Director of Constituent Services and Director of the Council on Human Rights under Governor Mark Warner. Dr. Trent earned a bachelor's degree in sociology and criminal justice from Hampton University and completed her master's and doctoral degrees in public administration and policy from the Virginia Commonwealth University. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Trent.
Good morning, Radford. I am so honored to be here at the inauguration of Dr. Brian O. Hemphill, the 7th president of Radford University. Members of the Board of Visitors, local government officials, students, faculty, staff, alumni, and guests, thank you for inviting me to speak on this special occasion. I would also like to recognize the presence of State Delegate Mark Keem, who's here from the Virginia Legislature. Thank you so much for being here. On behalf of Governor McAuliffe and the Commonwealth of Virginia, I bring greetings and best wishes to the Radford community as you embark on this wonderful journey together. I would also like to congratulate President Hemphill, not only for taking the reins at one of our leading universities, but for making the wise decision to move to the great Commonwealth of Virginia. Today, you will hear from a variety of individuals speaking about President Hemphill, Radford, and how essential his leadership will be in guiding this university to further success and achievement. But I would like to take a moment to recognize a few of the exciting things that are already occurring here on this campus. In many areas, Radford has been a leader in Virginia's efforts to meet the workforce demands of today. For instance, the Teachers for Tomorrow program that you have within the Pulaski County Public Schools, you are engaging and preparing high school students to enter into the teaching profession, a critical area where Virginia and the nation are experiencing severe shortages. Radford's cybersecurity program has been nationally recognized as a center for academic excellence. With over 17,000 unfilled cybersecurity job openings in Virginia today, Radford is helping us meet yet another critical shortage area. Radford also has innovative nursing, physical and occupational therapy programs, all areas that are highly competitive and areas in which there are needs throughout the Commonwealth. And finally, your Forensic Science Institute is known throughout the Commonwealth and the nation for its expertise in analyzing and processing forensic evidence. These are just a few examples of the many great things going on here. The bottom line, Radford is one of our leading institutions in producing the workforce and training we need to meet the new Virginia economy. Not only do you have great programs, but you have tremendous faculty and staff who are dedicated to excellence, preparing your students to be competitive. And that is particularly important because 94% of your student body here are in-state residents, the vast majority of whom choose to remain in the Commonwealth. That means that they're using the skills they learn right here, whether it's in cybersecurity, nursing, forensic science, or otherwise, to contribute directly to our shared economy. Like Governor McAuliffe, President Hemphill knows how important it is that we instill in our students not just a willingness to learn, but a passion and desire to positively impact our communities and to contribute to the larger society. That is the kind of leadership that has guided Radford to acclaim, and it is the kind of leadership that President Hemphill will continue to provide. Finally, to the students, the Highlanders in the audience. Today represents an enormous opportunity for you. Today you inaugurate a president who shares your enthusiasm and excitement. A president eager to get to work on your behalf and on behalf of the faculty and staff and the surrounding community. A president with a proven track record of innovative leadership and bold thinking. But as students, this is not only a huge opportunity, it's also a tremendous responsibility. You're now called on to work with President Hemphill to take Radford to the next level. I'm convinced that nothing can stop you but you. And I'm convinced that you are all up to the task. Once again, I offer my sincerest congratulations to President Hemphill, the students and the Radford community, and I thank you for having me.
veteran of Virginia higher education in Virginia, Peter A. Blake joined the State Council of Higher Education for Virginia as interim director in April of 2011 and became director in January of 2012. Mr. Blake previously worked at CHEV as an associate director overseeing higher education analyses. He was Deputy Secretary of Education and Secretary of Education under former Governor Mark Warner and has served as the legislative fiscal analyst for the Virginia General Assembly's House Appropriations Committee. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Peter A. Blake.
Good morning, Radford community. What a beautiful day. President Hemphill, Dr. Hemphill, Rector Wade, faculty, staff, students, alumni, friends, and family, thank you for inviting me to be part of this ceremony. It's an honor to be here today as Radford University inaugurates its seventh president. I also want you to know that when you were announced, Mr. President, I did a little investigating. Radford University is a vital part of our system of higher education, and I wanted to see what sort of new president we were getting in the Commonwealth. I did what I had to do, Mr. President. So I checked you out with my counterparts in other states. I asked all the tough questions, and I'm happy to tell everyone here today that they assured me that you, President Hemphill, are the right fit for the right time at Radford University. Right now, Virginia is engaged. He is, truly. Right now, we're engaged in Virginia in an all-hands project to ensure that the state takes its rightful place as number one in education in the country. With the help of many people across the Commonwealth, and in fact, the help of many people here today, we develop what we call the Virginia Plan for Higher Education, which will help get us there. I'll save you the details of the plan. But with your help, the Virginia Plan will make Virginia the best educated state in the nation by 2030, with 1.5 million additional degrees and certificates in the next 14 years, we will make Virginia the Commonwealth of Education. So thank you, Radford community, for taking part in this important work. President Hemphill, thank you for assuming leadership of this great university at this important time. And on behalf of the State Council of Higher Education, our Chair Gil Miner and Vice Chair Haywood Fralin, I bring you deep gratitude for your service and best wishes for the future as we kick off the next era of Radford University. Thank you and congratulations.
Ladies and gentlemen, next we will hear a series of greetings from Radford University's shared governance bodies. First, on behalf of the students, will be Ms. Jacinda Jones, President of the Student Government Association. She will be followed by Dr. Carter Turner, President of the Faculty Senate, speaking on behalf of the faculty. He will be followed by Ms. Sandra Bond, President of the Administrative and Faculty Senate, speaking on behalf of the administrative and professional faculty. And she will be followed by Ms. Marie Testerman, President of the Staff Senate, speaking on behalf of the classified staff. Ms. Jones.
Good morning. It has been a pleasure to have the opportunity to work with President Hemphill. He is truly a remarkable individual. He takes the time to meet students and to get to know them. He will listen to your concerns and give helpful education and career advice. As a student, there is nothing better than having a president that is student-centered. You can walk through Dalton Hall almost any day during lunchtime and find President Hemphill eating in the dining hall. I remember the first time I met President Hemphill. I thought to myself, wow, he is really a people person. I am excited to work with him this upcoming academic year. On July 1st, 2016, I remember President Hemphill sending out a welcoming email to the university the first thing in the morning. Again, I thought, wow, he is on it. I know he has great things planned for this university. As a senior, I look forward to graduating and becoming an alumni of this university because I know President Hemphill is going to do great things during his tenure at Radford University. I'm excited to come back years from now and see the new heights President Hemphill has taken Radford University to. I am very eager to continue working with President Hemphill for the remainder of this academic year. Thank you.
On behalf of the faculty, it is my honor and privilege to congratulate Dr. Brian O. Hemphill on his selection as Radford University's 7th president and to welcome his beautiful family to our community. I met Dr. Hemphill for the first time last spring when he came to campus to meet with different constituencies well before he officially started the job. While I had heard good things about Dr. Hemphill, I was anxious to hear directly from him, to hear his vision for Radford, to get a sense of his leadership style, and to ask him questions about some of the tougher issues we were facing as a university. At some point in the discussion, Dr. Hemphill made a promise that has stuck with me ever since. Dr. Hemphill explained that he couldn't guarantee that he and the faculty would always see eye to eye. In fact, he was certain there would be times when we didn't. But what he could guarantee, what he promised, was his commitment to spending time with us at the table, hearing our concerns, working to understand our challenges and needs, supporting us so we can do our jobs effectively, and including us in the process of moving this university forward. I'm not entirely sure why his promise made such an impression on me. It's hard to imagine a new university president telling the faculty anything different. But there was something different about what he said and how he said it. It was honest, and it was fair, and it was exactly what we needed to hear from our new leader. I cannot express how pleased I am to share that in the 3.5 months since Dr. Hemphill took over the helm at Radford, he has, without question, lived up to his promise. He has made himself available to faculty, sometimes on very short notice, and sometimes at great inconvenience to himself. He has extended to faculty the opportunity to bring their ideas forward on nearly every conceivable issue this university faces. And he has shown a willingness to adjust his plans in response to faculty needs and concerns. He has done exactly what he said he would do and exactly what we need done at Radford. Ideas are good, but there is no shortage of ideas in the world. Hard work is important, but people can learn to work hard. What Dr. Hemphill brings to Radford is the most elusive and important of all qualities, leadership. And it's leadership that will continue this university's great tradition of academic excellence and will position us to face the challenges of higher education's quickly changing landscape. So I congratulate Dr. Hemphill on being selected Radford University's next president. And just as importantly, I congratulate Radford University for selecting him. We're in good hands. Thank you.
Today, I am honored to bring greetings as the president of the administrative and professional faculty. My colleagues represent a wide network of individuals that share their passion each day to make Radford University a shining star, and President Hemphill is no exception. I've been asked to share my personal reflections about President Hemphill, and three simple but very powerful words showcase the impact he has made already on our campus and beyond. I had to look no further than the Alumni Association tagline, celebrate, connect, and contribute. Celebrate. President Hemphill celebrates Radford University in every conversation. He believes in us. He believes in the Radford community, and he has united the Radford family. Connect. President Hemphill has connected the entire campus and our beloved alumni. I've had the privilege of traveling throughout the Commonwealth in North Carolina with the Hemphill family on the presidential alumni tour. The energy at each location was amazing. Our alumni gravitated towards him, encouraged them all to come home. Contribute. President Hemphill contributes his time to Radford. When he selected Radford University, he didn't just put his toe in the water to test the temperature. He completely submersed himself in the Radford community. President Hemphill has cheered loudly at athletic events, lugged boxes during move-in, hosted students and staff at his home, and even took time out of his busy schedule this week to come speak at our AP Senate meeting. Wow. We truly have the right person leading our university. President Hemphill, welcome, congratulations, and thank you for helping us remember why we love Radford.
I am honored to speak at the inaugural address of the 7th president of Radford University. As president of Staff Senate, I represent classified staff and wage employees. The first time that I met Dr. Hemphill was in April. He requested a meeting with the Staff Senate executive officers, and he asked each of us to complete a biography, which indicated to me that he was interested in getting to know us. While anxious to meet Dr. Hemphill and get acquainted with him, I was still very nervous. As I listened to his discussions about his visions for Radford University and how we must find our niche and how his path for us to move forward, I forgot about my anxiety and I realized that Dr. Hemphill was very passionate and very committed to Radford University. The second time that I spoke with Dr. Hemphill was May the 18th. The reason I can remember the exact date was because it was the day of the Staff Senate picnic. There was a 50% chance of rain, and the weatherman was not cooperating with my decision of whether to have the picnic inside or out, and the decision had to be made. Ashley, Dr. Hemphill's chief of staff, called and said that he was on his way to a meeting, but that he really wanted to speak with me. As I listened to Dr. Hemphill discuss how student enrollments were down and how this would affect the university as a whole, I remembered thinking, who does this guy think that I am? He must have me confused with someone else, someone that he thinks is important, because I'm just the president of Staff Senate, and why would he be having these discussions with me? I even had this conversation with several of my coworkers, and they agreed. He must have your position confused with someone else. I have since come to realize that not only does Dr. Hemphill think that my thoughts and my input is important, but he thinks that all of our thoughts and input is important. As my phone continued to blow up over in my emails over people wanting answers about the Staff Senate picnic, I couldn't help but hope that our new president would indeed include staff on the day-to-day operations of the university. On July 22nd, Dr. Hemphill held an open forum, and I did say open, with classified staff. The auditorium was packed. At the end of Dr. Hemphill's presentation, he opened the floor to questions. One of the discussions pertained to the Student Fitness Center, and the fact that a lot of staff had never even seen the inside of the facility, and would there ever be the possibility that we would be able to use it? On August the 15th, less than a month, we received an email stating that there would be an open house at the fitness center, and it encouraged faculty and staff to come and explore the facility. Not only would there be an open house, but there were rates that were listed that employees could have memberships. So something that many here at Radford thought would never happen. At the convocation, Dr. Hemphill spoke these words: "There is nothing that we cannot accomplish together, absolutely nothing, if we are willing to lock arms for the common good of the Radford family. There is nothing that we cannot achieve." I wholeheartedly agree with Dr. Hemphill on this, and I am excited about the future of Radford University with Dr. Hemphill as our seventh president.
Kevin Rogers, class of 1987, is founder and chief revenue officer for CipherPath Incorporated, a Silicon Valley-based information technology infrastructure software company. Also, as president of Radford University Alumni Association, he extends greetings on behalf of the over 72,000 alumni around the world. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Kevin Rogers.
Good morning.
And good morning, Dr. Hemphill, President Hemphill, and Mrs. Hemphill. On behalf of the Radford University Alumni Association, congratulations to President Brian O. Hemphill on his inauguration as the seventh president of Radford University. We appreciate the tremendous outreach of President Hemphill, what he's made in our community, and for all the alumni across the Commonwealth of Virginia and beyond. Your enthusiasm and pride in our alma mater encourage all of us to strive for excellence. Our original seal, the beehive, represents the industriousness of many working collectively together for the common good, while providing the human capital, and that is you, the students, with the needed resources to metaphorically grow colonies and pollinate crops around the world. Our colony of more than 72,000 alumni is proud to support your vision, and we look forward to contributing in as many ways as possible to help you, to help the dedicated professors and staff members at Radford University on this exciting new journey. Together, we will implement new and innovative approaches to grow and drive a thriving global community of alumni hives to engage and enhance Radford University while celebrating our proud history and traditions. Fellow alumni, please rise and join me in presenting a gift to Dr. Hemphill. President Hemphill, we thought long and hard about what we could get you to remind you of the 72,000 alumni that stand behind you. I'm proud to say that a beehive in your backyard with approximately 72,000 bees is low maintenance, easy to take care of, and only takes up 9 square feet. So we decided not to do that. Well, maybe. I'd like to present this bow tie, which is a custom-made bow tie. It's in the colors of the Radford University logo, and it's a honeycomb. Every time you wear this, Dr. Hemphill, we hope that you remember that you have 72,000 alumni standing behind you on this new journey. Be loud, be proud, go Highlanders.
Radford University is so fortunate to have an outstanding town-gown relationship with our namesake, the city of Radford. Much can be attributed to this man and his service to our community, Mayor Bruce Brown. Now providing greetings on behalf of the city, let's welcome Dr. Bruce Brown.
Well, good morning, Highlander Nation. How are you? All right. I am honored and humbled to participate in today's investiture ceremony. President Hemphill, esteemed members of the platform, colleagues representing other universities, guests, alumni, members of the Radford University faculty and support staff family, and most especially, the students of Radford University. As the proud mayor of the city of Radford, President Hemphill, on this most memorable and historic day, I have the singular honor to bring to you from the citizens of Radford their warm and heartfelt appreciation and greetings and best wishes as you embark on leading this university. It's only been a few short months ago that indeed a fresh, what some would call invigorating wind blew into the River City. His name is President Brian Hemphill, and he's accompanied by his accomplished wife, Dr. Marcella Roses Hemphill, and two very special and beautiful children, Cruz and Catalina. They arrived to grace and actually inspire both the campus and our city. Radford City and Radford University have shared a long, storied, and very close relationship for well over 100 years. From the time when Radford College was founded in this city and took its name, we are proud to be the home to Radford University. In addition to being a vital and valued educational institution, this university is the single largest economic engine for our city and indeed this region. Since President Hemphill became the president of Radford University, there really has been and been alluded to a whirlwind of activity as he has set a non-stop pace. He does regularly greet genuinely students, faculty, and staff on campus, and perhaps even more importantly, he articulates a clear, positive vision for Radford University as he meets with alumni throughout the Commonwealth, as he describes his hopes and desires for the future of their alma mater. Dr. Hemphill, your message has resonated throughout the Radford University and Radford City community, and indeed the Commonwealth. Students and faculty and staff and alumni already speak of how they have been inspired and energized by your leadership, your sincerity, and yes, your charisma as our seventh president of Radford University. One of the first things that President Hemphill did was ask Carrie and I to have dinner with him back in January when he first was taking the reins, and this was well before he officially took the office. So I've had the personal privilege of exchanging ideas and aspirations with Dr. Hemphill, and he can count me and this city among those that are here to help him move this university forward. You and your family have embraced the community, and believe me, Mr. President, our citizens have embraced you too. They are delighted to go down to our farmers market and run into you and your wife and the children on a Saturday morning, or while you're out frequenting many of the restaurants in our area. It did not go unnoticed that you were one of our most visible visitors to our 4th of July Spirit of America celebration down at Bissett Park. And it's even been reported that they've seen you cross the bridge at Kroger's and Walmart. We are filled with excitement and hope as together we embark on this next chapter in our university's history, and we pledge to continue to work with you as you lead this university to the next level of excellence, which is sure to come under your transformative leadership. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Janetta Cross Brazell of McDonough, Georgia, has vast experience in student affairs field, including serving as the Vice Chancellor for Student Affairs at the University of Arkansas until her retirement in 2009. She earned a bachelor's degree in history and political science from Spelman College in 1968, a master's degree in American history from the University of Chicago in 1972, and a PhD in higher and adult continuing education from the University of Michigan in 1991. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Janetta Brazell.
Good morning, Radford. I can't tell you how happy and truly flattered I am that Brian asked me to speak at his inauguration today. This is an exciting occasion that celebrates the rich history of Radford University and the great promise of where this outstanding university is heading under the leadership of its seventh president, Dr. Brian O. Hemphill. Brian has literally been preparing for this day since his earliest years working in student affairs. Those of us who have been fortunate enough to be his mentors, his colleagues, his family and friends are not in the least bit surprised to see him being installed today as your president. In 2001, I was chairing the Committee for the Minority Undergraduate Fellows Program at a national conference when a young man on the committee caught my attention. The clarity and depth of the ideas and insights he was bringing to the table were nothing short of impressive. I'm not ashamed to tell you, I basically stalked him afterwards to find an opportunity to ask if he would consider becoming a part of a philosophical change I was launching in the Division of Student Affairs at the University of Arkansas. To my delight, he said yes. In one of our initial meetings at Arkansas, I asked Brian a question that I've asked each of my direct reports. Where do you want to go with your career? This young man in his early 30s told me he intended to serve as a university president someday. I can tell you that of all the people I've mentored, Brian Hemphill has been and continues to be the most receptive to coaching, new ideas, and constructive criticism. From the beginning, he wanted to know everything I knew, and he just seemed to soak it all in, always with a thirst for more. This was clearly the nature of a man who aspired to be a successful university president, always listening, learning, and transforming himself, and inspiring others to do the same. At Arkansas, Brian's core values were completely aligned with my vision that every aspect of our efforts and resources at the university must be student-centered, enhance the student experience, bring coalitions and partnerships together that included all university stakeholders, and that we must intentionally build an organizational structure to support that vision. Does that sound familiar? He has taken this foundation many steps further, and now, as your president, will ensure that every faction of Radford University is reflective of that philosophy. Here are a few things that you should know about your seventh president. He believes in change, not just for the sake of changing, but because students, institutions, and higher education itself are rapidly changing landscapes. To ignore that truth would be to ignore the sustainability of this institution. He will thoroughly seek out your input and expertise, weigh the impacts of any change on students, the entire university family, your community and economy, and then he will put into motion a plan to shape another facet of the future of this university to ensure its solid contribution to the education of the generations to come. Knowing Brian as I do, my advice to you is to jump on the train, buckle your seatbelts, and be an active part of this exciting ride. You may have noticed already, your president is available to students, parents, alumni, university team members, and community partners. I have no idea where he gets the energy and finds the time to be as accessible and involved as he is, and it gives me a headache to even try to imagine keeping his calendar. But inclusivity and participation at all levels is a core element of Brian Hemphill. I don't even have to ask the students here who are involved in theater groups, athletics, student government, student leadership, and student activities if you've seen him at many, many of your events. I already know the answer. He not only attends, he personally acknowledges your work and activities, your leadership and your commitment to Radford University. He may also ask you about your grades and your class attendance. Don't even think about bluffing him. Most of the time, he already knows. All facets of the work at this great university culminate in the president. You've chosen an individual whose vision embraces the success of students throughout their university experience and beyond to the roles they undertake in their families, their careers, and their communities. This vision will be attained by the leadership of Brian Hemphill and the collaborative efforts of many here today. And it is the greatest legacy a university president and an institution of higher education can hope to achieve. I wish you the outstanding success you deserve, Brian. May you continue to have the love of a beautiful family, honest friends and colleagues, and the strength and vision to see the brightest future that is attainable for Radford University. All the best to you, my friend.
Thank you, Dr. Brazell, for those remarks and for your role in mentoring our new president. My name is George Lowe, and I am the Dean of the College of Business and Economics, and it is my honor and privilege to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. E. Gordon Gee, President of West Virginia University, and one of America's most prominent higher education leaders. In 2009, Time magazine named him one of the top 10 university presidents in the United States. In 2014, Gee returned to West Virginia University, where his career as a university president began many years earlier. Born in Vernal, Utah, Gee graduated from the University of Utah with an honors degree in history and earned his JD and EDD degrees from Columbia University. He then clerked under Chief Justice David T. Lewis of the U.S. 10th Circuit Court of Appeals and worked for U.S. Supreme Court Chief Justice Warren Burger. Gee returned to his home state of Utah as an associate professor and associate dean in the J. Reuben Clark Law School at Brigham Young University and was granted full professorship in 1978. That would be the first year that our paths crossed. I was a freshman at BYU in 1978. 1 year later, he became dean of the West Virginia University College of Law, and in 1981 was named West Virginia University president. He served in that role until 1985, when he went on to lead the University of Colorado until 1990, then Brown University from 1998 to 2000, and Vanderbilt University from 2001 to 2007. He served as president of The Ohio State University from 1990 to 1997, and again from 2007 to 2013. Gee has served in a number of important capacities for education governance organizations and committees, including chair of the American Council on Education's Commission on Higher Education Attainment. He has also served on the boards for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum, Limited Brands, and the National 4-H Council. In March 2015, he was elected to the board of directors of the American Council on Education, the nation's largest higher education organization. Guy has received numerous honorary degrees, awards, fellowships, and recognition, including fellow of the prestigious American Association for the Advancement of Science, and the Distinguished Alumnus Awards from the University of Utah and from the Teachers College of Columbia University. In 2013, he received the ACE Council of Fellows Fidelity Investments Mentor Award and received the Outstanding Academic Leader of the Year Award on behalf of historically black colleges and universities. He is the co-author of 11 books, including Law, Policy, and Higher Education, published in 2012. He is also the author of numerous papers and articles on law and education. Let's give a warm Radford welcome to our keynote speaker, Dr. E. Gordon Guy.
Thank you, George. That's exactly the way that I wrote that. You could have gone on a little bit longer, I think. But nonetheless, what a glorious day in the life of this university, isn't it? It really is. What a glorious day. And I'm grateful to be here. I am honored to be here. And on behalf of my dear friend, Brian Hemphill, who will serve ably as the seventh president of this university, I've had the privilege of knowing Dr. Hemphill for a long time and working with him on several partnerships during his presidency of West Virginia State University. I met his gracious wife, and I know that he's a proud and devoted father of his children, Jada and Jordan, who are here, as well of those adorable twins, Catalina and Cruz, and they're being very good right now. I will note that I have identical twin granddaughters who are exactly the same age, and they're coming and visiting this weekend at West Virginia University, and I've had to child-proof the whole university. It's amazing. But this I know, Radford has made the best possible choice in the leader. In fact, you've heard all of that. Brian, I was just thinking about this. You're so good, and you have so much goodwill here, I would quit. Brian made a huge impact at West Virginia State, where fundraising, retention, and graduation rates and out-of-state enrollment all surged during his tenure. Less tangibly, and I think I heard this from several of his colleagues in the faculty and staff senates here, but most importantly, his presidency brought a renewed energy and pride to that institution. I'm sorry that my state has lost Dr. Hemphill to our eastern neighbor, but perhaps we can still claim him, since many people around the country still think West Virginia is just the region surrounding Roanoke. Although Dr. Hemphill has had solid experience as university president, it is obviously taking on a new challenge as president of a much larger institution. And since I am here as acting as sort of the dean of university presidents, which translates into the oldest and most experienced president the event organizer could find who could still hobble to a podium, I hope Dr. Hemphill will not mind if I start by sharing some wisdom. As I'll explain in a few minutes, this is a challenging time to lead a large public university. Nationally, winds more potent than Hurricane Matthew are buffeting higher education, the form of state budget reductions, the student debt crisis, aging faculties, and public doubts about the value of college. Despite all of that, however, my advice is not run. Run like the Liberty Flames are chasing you down the soccer field, because I know Dr. Hemphill has the knowledge and the skill and the tenacity and the ability to navigate today's challenges. Because despite all of the challenges, I still believe higher education's best days are in front of it. I truly believe that. And because of all of that, leading a large public university is just great fun, I can tell you that. In fact, I thought, if you don't mind, I would just share a couple of things that just happened to me this week because they're kind of fun to show the nature. My own institution is 33,000 students and 20,000 faculty and staff, so you can imagine all the kinds of things that happen. And this I got Dear Dr. Gee, thank you so much for the flowers you sent on the occasion of my business expansion. As a West Virginia University alumnus, I appreciate the thought. However, I must tell you that the card accompanying the flowers said, "Rest in peace." There must have been some mistake, and I wanted to bring it to your attention. Now, I had to immediately ask my staff, what in hell's sake happened here, you know? And so finally, I sent back, this is from a guy in Wheeling, I sent back, "Dear George, oh my, this means that somewhere there's a funeral taking place today with flowers and a note saying, congratulations on your new location." But this one I thought was entirely appropriate in light of the fact that we're here today. We had our student, our parents' weekend this past weekend, and I got this note from a parent. She was a mother from Scotland who just sent me an email on Thursday concerning her son who is staying in one of our residence halls as a freshman. She wrote to me, "Presently, my son Donald is having a hard time adjusting to his living situation. He complains that his dorm mates are such terrible, noisy people. On one side, a guy keeps banging his head on the wall and does not stop. And on the other side, he hears screaming all throughout the night. So I asked my son how he dealt with all his noisy neighbors. He said, I do nothing. I just ignore them and go back to playing my bagpipes." Entirely appropriate that we're here this evening. So there is one thing I've learned in 36 years as a president. It is that humor is a wonderful tool for connecting with people. As long as you leave the Little Sisters of the Poor and your head football coach out of it, I might add. So without further ado, I present the top 10 reasons why leading a large public university is awesome. Number one, free parking. Number two, you get to attend every single faculty senate meeting. Do you know how much the average person would give for that opportunity? Number three, you get to live in a house with a name. Tyler House sounds so much classier than just an address, doesn't it? Number four is Dr. Hemphill knows a college president who wears bow ties appears intellectual and quirky compared to the average guy wearing bow ties who looks like an aging hipster. Number five, as president, you are the most popular guy on campus, at least when the blizzard rolls through and you get to declare a snow day. Number six, if you're nice to him, the Highlander might let you try on his kilt. Admittedly, though, the West Virginia University mascot, which is a mountaineer, will never let me shoot that rifle, I can assure you. And seven, you get to reach out to people on social media, and Dr. Hemphill has access to a better marketing tool than he may know, adorable young twins. Use them when you can. Number eight, at the Highlanders Festival Games, people will praise your hammer throw no matter how pathetic it is. Number nine, your autograph is in high demand, at least on diplomas at graduation time. And number 10, and finally, as a president, you will soon learn that the media hangs on every word you say. Trust me, there's no possible downside to that whatsoever. It's one of the reasons that I have so many jobs. The truth is, as a university president, you do command attention. You have the responsibility to set the tone from the top on campus, and obviously he is doing that. And to make sure that the university's vision and values are not just words on a page, but something every community lives every day. As a young president, I had the naive expectation that this would happen automatically. But I learned that our role as leaders is to make things right before they go wrong, to eliminate the possibility of wrong occurring, to nurture and maintain a culture that promotes excellence, creative thinking, and respect for others. Leading means engaging your whole campus in asking the important questions. For what purpose are we here? For what purpose do we conduct research? For what purpose do we teach? For what purpose do we raise funds and construct shiny new buildings and work hard to attract students? If it is to chase a claim or a higher slot in some arbitrary ranking, we do it for the wrong reasons. If we teach because it is what our contracts say we must do, we are here for the wrong reasons. If we conduct research without thinking of how it can improve and impact people's lives, we are here for the wrong reasons. If we learn because we must check off certain boxes on our path to a job, we are here for for the wrong reasons. Because the real reason we are all here today is the lunch, the ideas that will make our world a better place. We live in an era when ideas will be the catalyst of virtually all progress. The great fortunes of the world were once forged by muscle and sweat in the mills. Increasingly, today the great fortunes of the world are amassed from products of the mind. Smokestacks were once the metric of prosperity. Today, it is the college bell tower. Imagination today is what steel was 120 years ago, the very building block of our future. And that means that education has never been more vital. Education expands individual opportunity, stimulates the economy, and creates jobs. But it does more than that. It makes us free. And it opens the American dream to every one of us forever. That is the message that a university president must share tirelessly. Because this is an age of doubt. People have doubts about the economy. They have doubts about the future. They have doubts about our political process. And after what we have seen this election season, who can blame them? Some people even doubt higher education. For years, few questioned the value of a degree in building a successful life. As costs have soared nationwide, that value has come into question. The trend is understandable. Tuition prices have outpaced inflation for decades, and that has forced students and parents into borrowing. Wages for new college graduates have barely ticked up, while the average graduate's debt has more than doubled. It adds up to $1.5 trillion that our students owe on student loans. It adds up to a crisis. And it is not the only one we are facing. Our country is in danger of losing its status as the worldwide innovation leader. Compared to other nations, fewer of our young adults are earning college degrees. 4 in 10 students who start college fail to finish. And government investment in research is growing at a slower rate in America than in countries such as China. Meanwhile, while many campuses are plagued by what I call the tyranny of the gerontocracy, a strange concept I know coming from a person whose 70th birthday is in the rearview mirror, but today, faculty members are delaying retirement past age 65 at twice the rate of others who work in the workforce. It is great that we're able to contribute as long as possible, but this situation is making it hard for young faculty members to advance in academia, and the energy and new ideas that they bring to our profession is just as important as the experience and wisdom that older faculty provide. And all this is taking place as states continue to reduce budgets for colleges and universities, although I know I keep wanting to try to move West Virginia University across the border because I know Virginia has been more forward-thinking than many states about restoring funds and investing in higher education, and I congratulate the folks behind me. But these are challenging times, so challenging that a lesser leader than Dr. Hemphill might have slipped off the stage and tossed his regalia in the nearest recycling bin on his way out of town. He is not. He will not. That is because he is a great leader. And he believes, as I do, that moments of great challenge are moments of greatest opportunity. What this challenging moment demands is simply the best of us. It demands that colleges and universities exercise their power as the central force in the creation of progress. University presidents must think hard about the needs in their neighborhoods and in cities and villages around the world. They must have the vision to reimagine what education can and should be in this 21st century, and then they must have the will to make that historic change happen. They must make real strategic decisions about academic direction, about programs for investment and disinvestment. They must learn to say the word no, a word rarely used in higher education. They must be problem solvers, collaborators, innovators, and risk takers. Above all, presidents must be advocates for the value of higher education. The earnings gap between college graduates and those with a high school diploma has never been higher. over $1 million right now. Having an educated populace is also critical to our nation's future in the knowledge-based global economy. To maintain our innovation edge, we must educate more science, technology, engineering, and math leaders. But amid this push for STEM, we as presidents must also reinforce the value of the arts in this changing world. I call it STEAM. The arts, quite simply, nourish the soul. They make our lives richer, more compassionate, more fulfilled. They are, in fact, what makes us human. We must never forget that our schools, all types and all levels, are where the mind and the imagination flourish. We are repositories of human achievement, sanctuaries for the human spirit, and incubators of human aspirations. In this important moment, in these challenging times, we must go beyond the answers we must have always given and the boundaries we have always maintained. We must see our fellow institutions as allies, not opponents. There is infinite room in America and in American higher education for improvement, expansion, and collaboration. We must reach out and, as never before, to others of goodwill and common intent. We must initiate wholly new kinds of collaborations that extend our missions more completely and effectively to every corner of our nation and beyond. We must liberate energies imprisoned by long-held habits and habits of mind. But Mr. President, we have always done things that way. Is not an acceptable rationale for anything in higher education today. I strongly believe that freedom begets human creativity and goodwill. Making our own choices empowers us to take risks, to innovate, to fail, and to get up and try again and again. My experience working with Dr. Hemphill has shown me that he has the vision to navigate all of today's challenges and a passion for our education that will help Radford thrive as never before. He has the empathy to connect with students, and I just heard that from our student leader. At West Virginia State, he did not stay in his office. He was out and about constantly talking to students, faculty, and alumni. The student body president, who joined him at West Virginia State for lunch once a month, said, "I know how lucky I am. Whenever I talk to other student government people at conferences, they always say, like, he did that? Our president would never do that." Dr. Hemphill also has the fundraising acumen to generate new investments on campus. He has a proven track record for creating strategic partnerships. And Dr. Hemphill has the wisdom to promote the free and open discussions that is the cornerstone of a university. On a campus, people come together to argue and rebut, to debate and debunk. That is how we learn. That is how we challenge our own ideas and open our minds. Unfortunately, these days, we see minds closing and civil discourse withering all around us. We see in presidential primaries debates that resemble episodes of Jerry Springer. We see it across the internet, which has become a platform for rude and sometimes vicious commentary. We even see it on our nation's campuses where some students demand safe spaces and trigger warnings to protect them from opposing viewpoints. I know Dr. Hemphill believes in our students. And I know that a university's role is not to make people comfortable, it is to make them think. Because despite all the challenges we face, our nation still looks to higher education for solutions. They look to us because of the uniquely powerful role that education fills in American life. To fulfill our country's founding ideals of a meritocracy based on ability and action, to sustain our democracy through an informed citizenry, and to right the wrongs of bigotry and oppression, that is the American University. That is Radford. And Dr. Hemphill knows the reason. Thank you. Dr. Hemphill knows the reason colleges and universities are here, to help people live the American dream and to help our world advance beyond our wildest dreams. I know he will live that truth every day, and he will shout it from these Blue Ridge mountaintops. So I congratulate Dr. Hemphill on becoming Radford's 7th president. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gee. That was wonderful. Will Rector Wade and President Hemphill, could you both please join me here at the podium? Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the point of the ceremony where we formally install Dr. Brian O. Hemphill as the 7th president of Radford University. The presidential medallion and chain of office symbolize the authority vested in the office of the president by the Radford University Board of Visitors. The heavy chain symbolizes the weight of responsibility for the wearer, strength and unity, and strong communication. The images on the gold medallion connects the institution's past and its future, just as Dr. Hemphill will do as its new president. The mace within the university was adopted as a symbol of the power of the academic quest for truth and wisdom. It is carried in academic processions not only to bring authority to the ceremonial occasions, but also to emphasize the unity and aspirations of the collegial community. It is now my honor to present the Radford University mace to President Brian O. Hemphill. We have just heard many wonderful and well-deserved accolades about Dr. Hemphill. I would add, particularly on behalf of those of us who have had the privilege and continue to have the privilege of working very closely with the President, that what we have heard today is very accurate and it is very true. His energy and passion for leading our institution to new heights are infectious and inspiring, and there is indeed great excitement throughout our campus and also our community about the future. About our future. So now, it is my sincere honor to present the 7th president of Radford University, Dr. Brian O. Hemphill.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Let's be seated. Rector Wade, Provost Gartelli, thank you. I will hold these items sacred as a symbol of this institution and the importance of the position you've entrusted to me. I pledge to uphold the integrity and mission of this great institution throughout my presidency. First of all, join me in giving President Gee another hearty round of applause. I thank you for your message from 1995 that inspired me as I sat in Columbus, Ohio as a new professional in higher education. And I think Teresa Powell actually made that introduction. But little did I know that 21 years later, we would be sitting on the stage together. My friend, you have a witty sense of humor and a pretty good taste in bow ties. And you've served the American higher education as a trailblazer on so many levels and made opportunities for me and so many others. Join me in giving Gordon another hearty round of applause. Also join me in acknowledging Dr. Janetta Cross Brazil with another round of applause. Janetta, thank you for stalking me in that hallway in 2001. In part, I stand here today because of that single question. Are you happy in your current position? She didn't share that part. But thank you for your guidance, your support, and your brutal honesty. I am confident that I would not be at this podium today if it were not for the many lessons you taught me at the University of Arkansas as a Razorback. Thank you, Janetta. Let's acknowledge her one more time. I would also be remiss if I did not recognize my bosses, Rector Wade, Vice Rector Siddiqui, and the other members of the Board of Visitors that are with us. If you could please stand. I would like to really thank these individuals for their collective commitment to Radford University and devoting countless hours to ensure that this institution remains a high-quality educational provider for current and future generations of Highlanders. Let's give them one more round of applause. To A.J. Robinson, Ashley Shoemaker, Heather Miano, and the entire Presidential Inauguration Planning Committee, I'd like to thank you for your hard work, your dedication, the late nights in planning today's ceremony and all of the events for the week. Let's acknowledge the planning committee. Let's give them a round of applause. To my mentors, if you could stand as I call your name, John Peters, Teresa Powell, General Walter Johnson, Ann Brother Smith, Kay Goodwin, and Paul Hill. I would like to really thank all of you for your support, the sink or swim opportunities, and the occasional swift kick over the last 25 years that I'm sure I deserved. I also thank each of you for teaching me about accountability, expectations, and true leadership. And specifically to John Peters, who's with us here today, I want to personally thank you for teaching me how to display strength and courage during the darkest moment of our career, which was on February 14, 2008 at Northern Illinois University. You taught me so much about leadership during that trying time. I thank all of you and I love you guys. Give my mentors a round of applause. To my former cabinet members that are here, if you could stand, John Jones, Ainsley Carey, Angie Dreesen, Orlando McMeans, Kimberly Osborne, Pat Schumann, and Kamara Jazaria. I'd like to thank all of you for your hard work over the years, your friendship, and your words of wisdom. I'm so proud of each of you and your accomplishments and all that you're giving to students every day on our campuses across the country. Join me in giving these folks a round of applause. Thank you. I'd also like to acknowledge some of my closest friends that are with us here today, if you could stand when I call your names. Greg and Kim Burton, Diane Strong, Gary Swingle, Derek Gragg, and Billy Litscomb. I would like to thank all of you for your support, your words of encouragement, your generosity to help transform communities and provide so many opportunities for students. Your continued friendship is so special to me. I greatly appreciate you guys. Thank you for being with us today. Let's give them a round of applause. And I'd also like to acknowledge a number of my friends and colleagues that are here from West Virginia. And by the way, Gordon, it will get back to the papers about moving WVU out of the state. Just wanted you to know that. I know Robbie will probably write about it. I'd like for all of the West Virginia contingent to please stand. All of my friends and colleagues from West Virginia, if you could please stand. Jason, Chad, others, join me in giving all these folks a hearty round of applause. Thank them for being here today. Thank you. Joyce, thank you. To the Radford University Leadership Council, which includes our vice presidents and deans, if you could please stand. I'd like to acknowledge all of these individuals, not only for the work that they're currently doing, but the work that they know that we have to do going forward on behalf of this great university. Let's give these folks a round of applause one more time. And to my family, the Hemphill family, the Wilkins family, and the Rosas family, if you all could please stand. I'd like to thank all of you for being here. As a family, you know that we've experienced a lot of loss in 2015. We lost our mom, we lost our sister, and so many others in our family. But I can tell you, as I stand here today, I feel like they're with us. I cannot thank each of you enough for all of your love, your prayers, and your support. Acknowledge my family one more time, guys. Thank you. To my wife, my rock, Maricela Rosas Hemphill, I want to thank you for believing in me, loving me, supporting me, and accompanying me on this wild ride, and it's truly been a wild ride. The family, I love you, the family loves you, and now your Highlander family also loves you as well. Let's give her a hearty round of applause. Thank you. To my children, if you could stand, Jada, Jordan, Catalina, and Cruz. I'd like to acknowledge my kids. I'd like to say to you guys, I'm so proud of you to be able to see the young adults that you've grown into. I'm so excited and proud to see the mischief that Cruz and Catalina creatively gets into every day. I'm so proud of all of you. I love you guys. Give my kids a round of applause. To the platform party, including our distinguished speakers, the delegates who've joined us from across the state and the nation, our outstanding faculty and guests who fill the audience, good morning. Good morning, and thank you for being here. I'm honored and humbled to have the opportunity to stand before you as the 7th president of Radford University. Today is a day to reflect, on and celebrate the rich academic and the proud history of Radford University. A day to look with hopeful eyes to the promise of change and a prosperous future for this great university. From the time my family and I arrived on campus, we've been embraced by smiling faces, open arms, and Highlander pride. To the students, faculty, staff, alumni, and friends of Radford University, we say thank you. You've provided constant support, unwavering passion, and sincere optimism as we've navigated the past few months both personally and professionally. And without question, the New River Valley is a place where family and community come first. As you drove into Radford today, you may have noticed a sign that reads, quote, Radford is the heart of the New River Valley, end quote. With unwavering support from the entire Radford family, I cannot adequately express what it means to me to be the president of our university. When we began this journey together on July 1st, we made a commitment to excellence, accountability, transparency, and student-centeredness. With this commitment, we've pledged to focus on 6 areas: brand identity, academic excellence and research, student success, strategic enrollment growth, economic development and community partnerships, and philanthropic giving and alumni engagement. This commitment and areas of focus hold remarkable importance as we consider the challenges ahead, not only for Radford University, but also for the Commonwealth of Virginia. In the coming years, we will witness significant change across business and industry and at all levels of education. Policymakers and educators must be prepared to focus time and energy on meeting demands, especially in the growing areas of need, such as allied health, technology, and business, to name a few. The United States continues to lag behind industrial countries around the world in educational attainment rates. And when the numbers are examined, it is a narrowing pipeline from kindergarten to baccalaureate education and beyond. It is a major concern, but I'm proud to say to each of you that Radford University has already begun to make strides in this area, but we must do more in the years ahead to ensure that we have the skilled workforce needed to foster creativity and innovation and drive our economy to higher levels of promise and prosperity. In the realm of higher education, access and opportunity for all Virginians is key to this promise. Regardless of race, creed, color, or economic background, access must remain a top priority. No one should be denied an education based on affordability. An education is priceless because one's ability to learn and adapt never ends. Learning is indeed a lifelong pursuit and one that should not be taken lightly. Our universities are not only learning centers, but also economic engines for the Commonwealth and the nation. It is important that we acknowledge their impact on the growth of the local, regional, state, and national economies. When we commit to do all that we can, which the Radford family has proudly pledged to do so, collectively we can bridge the knowledge and skill gap and provide new opportunities for our students and our citizens. In order for Radford University to play its role, we must take several important steps. First, we must continue the journey of being student-centered. It must be in every aspect of our work. It must be a part of everything that we do. Let's pause for a minute and give our students a round of applause, our Radford students. Second, faculty must be active partners in the governance of this university. Could we ask all of our faculty to please stand, all of the Radford faculty? Let's give these guys a round of applause. Thank you so much for being here today. Thank you. Thank each of you. Third, we must be data-driven. We must be a data-driven university with clear measures of success and accountability at our core. And finally, we must adjust to the speed in which society is moving. For this to occur, we must focus on innovation and being responsive to societal needs. In terms of student-centeredness, we have to be nimble and committed to working with all of our students, regardless of their profile. Anyone can admit a student with a perfect SAT score and then tout their success as a university. This is not the real world. We must embrace our public mission and be dedicated to ensuring student success, all of our students. Today's reality, individuals want an education, but do not want to destroy their financial lives and futures to earn a college degree. Students want less time to degree completion at affordable rates. In essence, they have the same hopes and dreams that each of us here today had as college students. So how will we respond? How will Radford University emerge as a leader with regard to these challenges? Higher education is operating under an industrial model in a post-industrial society. And without question, when we examine our costs, it must be important that we take a look at that. We must look at the models of delivery and be committed to providing alternatives. It's clear, we must respond in order to thrive. The profile of the Radford student has changed over the last decade. Our success must be based on the achievements of those who we admit and the quality of our graduates. So how will we engage them in and out of the classroom? How will they leave this university? Will they be prepared to serve as strong citizen leaders? This is what's fundamentally important. This is what matters. In order for these efforts to be successful, we must engage the Radford family in its totality in planning and executing a bold and innovative agenda which positions us for the future. We must be innovative in every aspect of our work. Innovation must be our new normal. How will it drive our work? How will it shape the future of Radford University? Why is innovation important? It's simple. As a university, we must continually evolve to stay ahead of the competition. Competition is key. Our success will ultimately be determined by the commitment of faculty, staff, students, alumni, and friends to think outside of the proverbial box. For innovation to come to life in our organization, we must be willing to move beyond our single focus and look for new opportunities and niche markets. This will allow us to have meaningful conversations regarding accelerated degrees, interdisciplinary programs, and student success in bold and new ways. In looking to the future, it is important to face our current reality. There's increased competition from public, private, and for-profit universities. Folks, we have embraced the tradition here at Radford University, and now it's time to envision the future. Remember that the core of innovation is about the process of thinking in new and profound ways to improve results. Therefore, we will allow innovation to drive our strategic planning and witness our vision and mission come to life. As we think about our future, we cannot be complacent, arriving late and embracing a model that society has already passed. So what am I saying to each of you sitting here today? We should not try to be like any other university in the Commonwealth of Virginia. We have to be the very best Radford University that we can be. So As we prepare to travel a road of innovation with students at the heart of every decision, we will serve the Commonwealth as a model for innovation and creativity with a keen eye toward our six areas of focus. In doing so, something special will happen on our campus. We will transform Radford into an innovative premier university in the Commonwealth of Virginia and beyond with a keen focus on teaching, research, and service. That is our vision. Now, we will encounter challenges. I can promise you that. But I'm confident that together, as one Radford family, we can accomplish amazing things and advance our university. This will only happen if we collectively embrace the fact that society has changed right before our eyes. The universities that embrace these changes and meet the needs of this great country will thrive, and those that do not will fade like a morning mist. It happens every year across this nation. Universities and colleges are closing their doors. But as I stand at this podium before you today, I'm confident that Radford University will thrive. We will be a university on the cutting edge. We will be a university prepared to lead. Why am I so confident? Because I've looked into the eyes of our faculty and our staff. I've witnessed firsthand their dedication and commitment to the future of this great university. I've been moved by each of them telling our story. As I've said on numerous occasions, if we don't tell our story, someone else will tell it for us. And I'm proud to have the opportunity every day to tell our story. In recent months, our story has been one of forward-looking. And folks, that's just the beginning. I know that by working together, we will take Radford to unprecedented heights by embracing the tradition and envisioning the future, a future that will make a difference for the students who come to this campus with the desire for discovery and a dream of a better tomorrow. Ladies and gentlemen, the students are why we're here today. They're the reason we're here. They are why I dedicated my career to higher education. They're why I'm standing here before you as your president. Their intellect and creativity drive me each and every day to work harder, to make a difference, to push myself beyond the expectation that others have for me and the expectations that I have for myself as your champion, as your leader. The enormity of the trust you've instilled in me is my constant companion. It is present in every action and every decision that I've made and will make on behalf of this university. I promise to serve the Radford University and guide the Radford family by furthering our commitment to civility, unity, and respect, the hallmarks of this family. I pledge to fulfill the duties and responsibilities of president each and every day. I make this pledge today in front of those who have entrusted me with the future of Radford University. It is my pledge, it is my promise, it is our future. Thank you, God bless, and go Highlanders.
Wow. There you go. Thank you, President Hemphill. And I know I speak for on behalf of all of my colleagues, everybody here, that we are so excited to have you lead our community. We look forward with great anticipation to working with you in support of your initiatives and your wonderful vision. Thank you. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I ask you to stand for the singing of our alma mater, sung by the Radford University choruses, led by Dr. Meredith Bowen, and that will be followed by the benediction provided by Dr. Nathaniel Bishop.
Let us pray. Almighty God, again we give you thanks as we have gathered here in this convocation for the inauguration of our president, Dr. Brian Hemphill. As we are about to depart, we pray your blessings upon all of us in all of our relationships to Radford University, whether as students and faculty, leaders and staff, friends and supporters. May each of us come and go with inquiring minds, honest purpose, and a steadfast commitment to do your holy will. Help us all to guard this treasure, be blessed by it, nurture it, and also prepare it for the coming generations. Hear this, our prayer, as together we say, Amen.
On behalf of Radford University, I wish to thank each of you for attending this special day in Radford University's history. I remind you to please stay in place until the platform party, delegates, and faculty have recessed. I also invite you to participate in the barbecue luncheon provided in the tent right over there to your right. Thank you very much and have a wonderful day. Go Highlanders.
Thank you.